got some. Okay. I didn't know you had them here.
Good morning, everyone. Do you hear a couple of joys in your absence? These are my friends from Texas, and Caroline and Todd Scangaroni, and they're going to keep seated because it's hard to get up and stuff. You all have been praying for her, and she appreciates your prayers. She has pulmonary fibrosis. Continue praying for it, please. Thank you.
A couple of other pieces of information. Lynn G says thank you to all those members who furnished food for the meal for John and Johnny's family. It was delicious. And those who actually fry the food out before you actually get to the food, just fine. So that committee is working extremely well. And you had an insert your bulletin this morning. Would you go there with me, please? As you're finding that, know that years ago here in Plymouth, the Brethren Church used to sponsor Thanksgiving dinner on Thanksgiving Day. So it was you who drivers and preparers of that. It happened that the lady who was in charge of that got sick, and the president got sick early, and she had to drop away from that. So now it has gone back to the Ministerial Association, and everyone should know whether you would like to participate in that. Here's your opportunity to take the meals to the residents of the Red Rock and the economy. And on the back page of that, you'll see where there's opportunities to serve. Please put a dark X and a zero next to the where you're willing to do that, and just put it in the late offering, and we'll pick it up. If you could also be kind enough to sign it, so we'll know what it is you're willing to do. Trinity United Methodist Church is actually pushing this pretty hard, and we would be in cooperation with them. So if you can help, us do that, please do so. Okay, other words of announcement over here?
I have now picked a program for bringing in Christmas to the children's program. I am going to need lots and lots of kids this year, so please get with us. We can take them from little bitty to, I do have a couple spots where I need a able, a little bit older boy, junior high, high school, a boy and a girl to do more of a speaking part. So if you've got somebody involved in that and that would like to learn a few lines and that, I could use a couple of help. But I've got a lot of positions to fill. The more we can get, better. So we can take them. They're all cute little sheep that the living size. So everything all the way up through high school. Bringing Christmas is going to be December 6th, I think, on Sunday. It'll be after the or pitch and bigger food luncheons. Meet the kids.
Irma, right. You want to do us a favor and introduce that young lady sitting?
Just kick up lady sitting here.
I have the honor of having and Carol here. And they decided that
thank you.
Morning, good morning, how are you?
Hi.
How is everyone this morning? Good. What'd y'all do last night? What was yesterday? Did y'all go trick or treating?
Yeah.
No, you didn't. Did you get candy?
Okay.
Well, how many of you like to play games? You like to play games. Do you have board games that you play at home with your parents? What do you play? Shoots and ladders? Ooh, hops. What do you play? Candyland. I was trying to think of the name of that. What do you play? Bean bag toss. Okay. So we all like to play games. And games have rules, don't they? When you open your game, there's a paper that comes out and it has all the rules. And if you follow those rules, then you can play the game and not get in big arguments and things like that. Have you ever played a game with someone who does not follow the rules? You have? Do you follow the rules? Oh, okay, it's somebody else that doesn't follow the rules. Okay. Well, I've played a game with somebody that doesn't follow the rules, and it's not much fun because it just gets all mixed up and then people argue and it's just not good. Well, you know, in our life, we have rules that we have to follow. Did you know that? Just like playing a game, in our life, we have rules. And do you know what our rule book is? The Bible. The Bible has the rules that if we follow what God says, then life is just going to be that much easier for us if we follow the rules. When Jesus walked on the land, there were some guys, they were named Pharisees, they were called Pharisees, and they liked to ask Jesus all kinds of questions. And they liked to try to trick him and get him to say the wrong answer, but you know, Jesus never said the wrong answer. He knew what he was doing. Well, sometimes they would ask a question and try to trick him. But one day, a Pharisee came into the temple as Jesus was talking, and he said to Jesus, "What's the greatest commandment?" You know what the commandments are, the Ten Commandments, obey your parents, things like that. And Jesus said, this is what he said, if I can get it up here. "The most important one, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength." How strong are you? Very strong. You have to love the Lord your God with all your strength. "And the second commandment to this is love your neighbor as yourself. There's no commandment greater than these." So, in this game of life, as you grow up, just remember that if you follow the rules, and Jesus told us the most important rule was to love God, and the second most important rule was to love other people as you love yourself. If you can follow those two rules, then everything else will just fall into place. Do you believe that? Follow the rules? Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your rule book that you've given us so that we can follow it and we can know what you want us to do. Lord, help us today as we leave here to love you with all of our heart and our mind and our soul and our strength, and then help us to love other people the way that you want us to and the way that we love ourselves. In your name, amen.
Joys and concerns I'd like
Pratt Booker went in for his heart foundation on Wednesday. I think it went fairly well, but now he's not feeling good. He's home and recuperating, so it's good to continue to pray with him. Ron Luke had cataract surgery on Thursday morning. He was here this morning. He said he couldn't believe how clear and crisp he can see now that he's got the new, got the cataract taken out and got a new implant. Bless him as well. The Halloween party, I thought, went really well. They met at the Alec Building in north of town, and they were trying to serve some of the kids and parents of the Red Rock Inn and the Economy Inn. I think we had 30 or 40 there, although if I count them correctly. We had a great time. It was sponsored by the upstairs classroom and the street was awesome. And thank you, too. I know some of you donated, some of you were there to help with the furniture, getting ready and cleaning it. Doing some registration of the kids, so appreciate it. I was told that they're going to do it again next year. That's a good thing. Steve Green has asked to have his name put on the list. He's having some kidney problems at this time, so Steve, we'll put you on there as well. And thank you, all of our visitors that are here this morning and sharing with us. Let me ask you about the joys and or concerns you would like to share with us. If you'll just hold up your hand and you will leave it, or Tina will bring that microphone to you. I got this one. So close.
I just wanted to share a joy. I am the lead teacher for Sunday school for our new preschool group, and we had six kids in class today, and Mrs. Lottman's class joined us to sing, and there were probably at least a dozen kiddos coming out together, and it was just really filled my heart with joy to see all those kids coming to Sunday school and learning about God. So, parents, thanks for sending your kids. We're having a lot of fun.
I just wanted to report that David donated Cochran had another surgery this past Friday, and he's home and he's doing quite well. And a little, you know, real success for you. Thank you.
I was slow at the announcement time, but I was asked to remind all the ladies that belong to my hall that tomorrow at 1 o'clock we'll meet in the educational building. Marsha Kane will have a great presentation on the ball fields. Anyone's welcome. She's so passionate about ball fields. So please come at 1 o'clock next week.
Other joys and concerns? Seeing none, if you would be kind enough to take the hand of somebody next to you, please pray.
But deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom.
find somebody that you've not yet greeted this morning and welcome them to this worship hour.
Thank you. You bless us with all the bounty of your heavenly banquet. May the gifts we offer this day provide food and drink to those who go without, that all may come to know the blessings of your table in this world and in the world to come. Amen.
Thank you.
back page of your bulletin, you'll find our scripture lesson for this morning. I'm going to stay up here with all the high blood my animal and this little sword. I don't know what I'm talking about. Forgive me for that. Everything else will be as in one. This comes from the reading of Mark, the 12th chapter, verses 28 through 34. Read with me, please, as we find it to be the inspired word of God. One of the teachers of the law came and heard him debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" "The most important one," answered Jesus, "is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these." "Well said, teacher," the man replied. "You are right in saying that God is one, and there is no other but Him. To love Him with all your heart, with all your understanding, and with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself, is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." And from then on, no one dared ask him any more questions. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Won't you be seated, please? Let me remind you that today is the first Sunday of the month. We will be participating in Holy Communion. We have decided that this month we would like to have you stay in your pews, and the ushers will come forward and bring to you first the bread, then we will consume that, and then secondly we will have the cup and go to it. All of you are invited, all of you are welcome to participate in the sacrament of Holy Communion. I'm going to ask you to pray with me as we prepare our hearts for today.
Figured out that the other two brothers also have a ring, and that two of them must be fake.
Only one could be the original.
So they went to the local magistrate, asking the judge if he would decide which ring was the original ring, and thus the error apparent of that tailor. The judge, however, could not distinguish between the three rings, and he said, "This is what we will do. We will watch, and we will see which son behaves in the most gracious, generous, and kind-hearted manner. Then we will know the son that possesses the original ring." And from that day forward, each son lived as if he owned the original ring. No one could tell between the three sons which one was the most gracious, the most generous, and the most kind-hearted. The pastor then said to the lady inquiring, "If you wish to know which religion is true, watch and see which one reveals the love of God for this world." Hear the parable? Today's word is love. Dear Ann Landers, I am a 46-year-old divorced woman with three grown children. After several months of chemotherapy following a mastectomy for breast cancer, I started to put my life back together when my doctor called with the results of the latest checkup. They found more cancer, and I was devastated. My relatives had not been supportive, as I was the first person in my family to have cancer, and they did not know how to react to me. They tried to be kind, but I had the feeling that they were afraid it was contagious. They called me on the telephone to see how I was doing, but they kept their distance. Last Saturday, I headed for the laundromat. You see the same people there almost every week. We exchange our greetings, we make small talk. As I pulled up in front of the laundromat, I was determined I was not going to appear depressed. However, when the young man who was leaving the place with his bundle of clean clothes stopped and said, "Good morning, and how are you?" I lost it, and I cried out, "I have cancer again," and then began to cry. He placed his arms around me and just let me sob. Then he said, "I understand, as my wife has been going through this too." And after a few moments, I felt much better. I stammered out a very weak thank you, and then proceeded inside with my laundry. It wasn't 15 minutes later the young man returned with his wife, and without saying a word, she walked over, she hugged me, and then she said, "I've been there too. Feel free to talk to me anytime. I know what you're going through." And I cannot tell you how much that meant to me. Here, a total stranger, taking her time to give me an emotional support and courage in the face of the future at a time when I was ready to give up. Oh, I hope God will give me the opportunity to do the same for someone else, exactly what that wonderful woman has done for me. And meanwhile, Anne, please let your readers know that even though there are a lot of hard-hearted people in this world, there are some incredibly generous and loving ones, too. The word for today is love. By now, most of us are mature enough in our spiritual journey to know that the entire scripture, the entire Bible, is about relationships. All of it is about relationships. Our personal relationship with God, and secondly, our personal relationships with each other. Literally everything in the Bible is meant to teach us how to love God and how to love our neighbor. Early church declared the entire Christian life consisted of relating to people all around us, particularly by serving our other, serving others. We said that. We are just as smart as the first century people. Love God, love others, serve others. It has been our watchword for several years now. And it could be even more true. The entire Protestant Reformation echoed the same thought when it declared that the Christian life is consistent in how we relate to people around us.
One truth stands vitally clear. From Adam to Jesus, and from Martin Luther to Martin Luther King, is this: it is impossible to please God without loving our neighbors. Let me repeat that. It is impossible to please God without relating and loving to our neighbors. The word for today is, thank you. You know it, I know it. We cannot truly follow after the pattern of Jesus Christ until we learn to love those around us. And I don't mean just here in this room. We'll talk about family in just a minute. But no one can be said to be an entire, complete person until they are able to love and be loved at the same time. Now, whom are we to love? Well, we can begin with all those that are around us and closest to us and dearest to us, and it can start at home, the wonderful place to begin. I attended a wedding that was not held in the church. In fact, it was held on the family farm. And the reason that it was held on the farm was because the mother of the bride had an advanced stage of Alzheimer's, and she could not walk. In fact, she was confined to the wheelchair, and all she could do was groan. That was her entire vocabulary, was groaning, and she did that most of the time. It was easier for the family to transport her out to the family farm than it was to take her to town and climb the 15 steps up to the sanctuary level of that church. When I arrived at the farm, it was actually decorated quite nicely with white and yellow flowers. Members of the wedding party were graduates that I was aware of, at least from Northwestern, Standard, Duke, and Dartmouth. They all had MBAs, and they all had law degrees. They were bright. They were educated. They were beautiful people who had the misfortune of being keenly aware of their elite status in life and were willing to show it. Now, before the wedding ceremony began, several strong ushers took the mother, one with the Alzheimer's, up the aisle and sat her on the front row, and she groaned at every jostle that they had in taking her up front. The father of the bride sat next to his incapacitated wife and held her like a child. When the ceremony started, the minister repeated the vows that we who are married have all taken. I, Andrew, take thee, Melissa, to be my wedded wife, to have and to hold, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health. And then it happened. You can see that the Spirit of God was working on those young people. Suddenly they were not so sure of being so bright, beautiful, and arrogant, whose future was based solely upon money, power, and prestige. All of those things, with they thought, made their life complete. It was as if, for the first time in their lives, in their young lives, they realized that things just might not turn out the way that they thought they might. Somehow, some way, and in some day, it might all horribly go wrong. 30 years earlier, the mother and the father of the bride, who was now cradled in her husband's shoulder, spoke the same wedding vows. And everyone at that party was begin to thinking, look at them now, she can do nothing more than tears literally welled up in their eyes. Realized that life does not always play out the way that we had planned it. The father of the bride cared for his spouse, as he promised to do, and loved her until the end of her life. The word is love. Can you love like that? God does. Jesus does. And wants us to follow suit. Can we? But if our love is to be all-encompassing, as Scripture tells us it should be, more Christ-like, then it cannot stop at home. It has to go beyond. It is probably easier loving people at home, but what does it say about the clerk at the convenience store who speaks very little English? Or the surly waiter at your favorite restaurant? What about the person who cuts you off in traffic when she or he is not paying attention and are texting or talking on the phone? What about the homeless person who comes to you for a handout? The true test of our Christian love is not how we treat people at home, although that is certainly an important area that we could all improve in. But it's how you treat those folks that are, what's the word that I want? Undeserving of our love, of our compassion, of our grace, of our generosity. Mike Brenneman is a homeless man who spent most of his night sleeping in a cemetery near Boston University. Mike had used drugs since he was a teenager and eventually was addicted to heroin. In the late 1990s, after a detoxification program, Mike was determined to carve out a new life for himself. He worked part-time moving furniture, but when he wasn't working his job, he spent time in the Boston University Library, where it was warm and hospitable. Unlike many of the other homeless persons who were there, Mike began taking advantage of the library for more than just a place to keep warm on the cold Boston nights. Since he was a little boy, Mike Brenneman always wanted to write. It was a passion for him, and so he began looking for those books and how to do freelance journalism, and read, and read, and read. He began taking little strips of paper and began writing down things for himself and began his craft in writing. One day, Mike came across a room that was filled with computers, and he asked another student if that student would be kind enough to show him how to operate the computer. Mike knew nothing about computers. And this kind student offered Mike a few quick lessons in how to turn it on, get started, it up. Just one act of kindness from some unknown student gave Mike Brenneman the dignity that he needed, treating Mike with kindness and treating Mike with patience instead of scorn was crucial on Mike's road to recovery. Mike's first major article for a local newspaper netted him $1,000, which then placed a roof over his head. And since then, Mike has written and has been published in Newsweek and other major magazines. He has since written a book. Just one unknown student providing a kind act that helped change a homeless man's entire future. Wouldn't you like to make a difference like that in somebody's life? The word is, Christ-like love. Like the husband who at their daughter's wedding owns his wife who suffers from the advanced Alzheimer's. Or the unknown student who just offered a few quick hints. Helping a homeless man operate a computer. Do you have that type of ability to love? There are people in this very room that do. There's only one place that that kind of strength can be found, and that is by opening up your heart, opening up your mind to the words of God, whose real name is love. What are the two great commandments? Love God and love your neighbor. Do these two things, and you will not be far from the kingdom of God. Would you bow your heads with me, please, and let's prepare ourselves for receiving the Holy Spirit. Lord, we're asking your presence with us here tonight. As we continue with our service for this evening in the Holy Sacrament. In Jesus' name we pray. Jesus was with his disciples on that fateful night. He took a loaf of bread and began the ritual, a sacrament that exists. To take this little piece of bread and break it and give it to the disciples on his left and on his right, and said, "Take this and eat it all over. Because it represents my broken body given for you." Likewise, after supper, he takes the cup. And he asked the Lord to bless the contents of that cup and give it to the disciples on his left and on his right, and said, "Drink this all over. And let it be for you representation of the new covenant that you are establishing between you and God." I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward. They will take the bread and bring it to you. You don't need to go in or just take a piece of it and pass it from your apron to the next person. Please hold the bread until we can all consume it the same.
Thank you.
broken heart. Okay.
Thank you.
You'd be on page number 622, if you would turn there with me, please, and stand. It'll also be on the big screen. There is a fountain filled with blood. Verses 1-5. Thank you.